Mr. Meeks is a graduate of Mercer University in Milton, Georgia, where he majored in chemistry. And he joined the Food and Drug Administration as an inspector in 1937. He has been stationed in such places as Atlanta, New York City, and Cincinnati. And he has been in Cincinnati since 1950. This morning, Mr. Meeks will talk to us on device quackery. Mr. Meeks.
I have some exhibits of devices here. Many of these products, or most of them, I guess all of them, are products against which the government has taken action for being misbranded or in violation of law one way or another. Authority to regulate the interstate movement of mechanical devices was provided for the first time in the Federal Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act of 1938. Prior to that time, there was no control over these devices. Although the term device does not appear in the designation of the Act, which is the Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act, devices share with foods and drugs and cosmetics the enforcement activities of the Food and Drug Administration. A device is defined in the statute as any instrument, apparatus, or contrivance, including its components, parts, and accessories, intended for the diagnosis, cure, mitigation, treatment, or prevention of disease in man or other animals, or to affect the structure of any function of the body of man or other animals. The labeling requirements for devices closely parallel those for drugs, except for the declaration of active ingredients. A device must meet the same labeling requirements as those of a drug. Responsibility for truthful labeling, which ensures safe and efficacious use of a device, is solely that of the manufacturer or distributor who introduces it into interstate commerce. The Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act provides that a device shall be held to be misbranded if its labeling is false or misleading in any particular, if its label fails to bear the name and place of business of the manufacturer, packer, or distributor, an accurate statement of the quantity of content, adequate directions for use, adequate warnings against misuse. A device further must not be dangerous to health. There is a provision in the regulations which exempts from adequate directions for use those devices which we call prescription devices. Now, these are not prescription devices. A prescription device is considered separately since its potentiality for harmful effects, method of use, or collateral measures necessary for its use, require the supervision of a practitioner licensed by law to direct the safe use, and hence the adequate directions for use by the layman cannot be prepared. Now, an example of that type of device is the X-ray machine. Regulations further provide, however, that to meet these requirements, a device must be sold only to or on the prescription of a physician. It must bear the prescription legend, which for drugs reads, "Caution. Federal law prohibits federal law restricts this device to sale by or on an order of a physician." The labeling information and directions for use of the device are already and always are available to the licensed practitioner. Relying on a worthless medical device for diagnosis or treatment of a disease is a highly dangerous practice for anyone who has a serious ailment. Yet thousands of such machines are still in use in the offices of health practitioners of various kinds, despite the efforts of regulatory agencies, voluntary health organizations, and professional groups to remove them. The public must be warned that there are no cure-all machines which are capable of diagnosing or treating different kinds of diseases simply by turning dials and applying electrical contacts to the body. Such devices are fake. Persons who suspect that they are being victimized through use of a device should communicate with the nearest office of the Food and Drug Administration or the equivalent state agency, and if possible, give the name of the machine, its manufacturer, and where they bought it, or where they received treatment from it. Mechanical quackery began thousands of years ago when people first invented charms and fetishes to ward off evil spirits and cure disease. In modern times, the discovery of electricity has made new techniques of medical diagnosis and treatment, for example, the X-ray, which has saved millions of lives. But along with the development of legitimate scientific devices came a host of weird machines offered to cure anything. At the turn of the century, the medicine man began to throw away their snake oils and peddle electric belts that cure by magnetism, and other gadgets simply gave the gullible a harmless jolt of electricity. We have examples of both these types. As people became more familiar with electricity and the novelty of being shocked wore off, the device promoter dreamed up more sophisticated machines, some of them claiming to generate unknown forces. By the time Congress included in the Federal Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act authority over devices used in the diagnosis or treatment of disease, devices that were supposed to cure every ailment known to man by means of colored lights, dangerous gases such as ozone and chlorine, radio waves, heat, vibration, and massage were on the market. Dozens of dangerous contraceptive devices were on the market, some of which caused fatal complications. Lead nipple shields, an old-time device, is a notable example of those devices, and it caused lead poisoning in babies. In an age when a machine whirls man around the earth at a speed of 17,000 miles an hour, it is easy to believe that a machine can do anything, if one can find the right machine. Medicine, like space science, does have its miracle machine. The electrocardiograph helps the doctor to study the action of the heart. The x-ray and the hand diagnosis and treatment. But the real miracle of scientific medical instruments has given the charlatan many new ideas for his fake machines and made it easier for the public to believe in them. Older people with chronic diseases are particularly apt to be taken in by this type of medical swindle. Interstate traffic in hundreds of such articles has been stopped in the 29 years since the Food and Drug Administration has held authority to act. Some of the most notorious medical swindles of all time were exposed in these court actions, several of which I will review briefly. The spectrochrome, a colored light projector, which you see over here, was distributed through a healing cult organized by a gentleman named Denshaw P. Gadiali. Approximately 10,000 members of this organization paid dues to local chapters called Planet. Group leaders who taught the use of the light machine were called normalizers. Treatment could be given only during certain phases of the moon, with the body pointed in a north-pointing position so as not to run counter to the magnetic rays of the earth. Mr. Gadiali was convicted after 6 weeks' trial, fined $20,000, put on probation for 5 years. When his probation expired, Mr. Gadiali resumed his activities, and in 1958 was again called before a federal judge. The court at this time issued an order or an injunction prohibiting further violations. A prison sentence can result if an injunction is not obeyed, because then he is in contempt of court. Another one, I believe Mr. Lincoln showed you this one yesterday, was the Ferguson Xeris applicator. It was a plastic device, if you recall, with two large balls on the end of it connected by plastic. This device was supposed to contain Xeris water, Z-E-R-R-E-T. The inventor claimed that this was similar to heavy water, and that it exerted rays that he called Z-rays, a force which he said was unknown to medical science or any other science. The product was called Z-rays since they traveled in a Z figure. They didn't travel in a straight line like electromagnetic waves, but these fell this way. Like all other electromagnetic rays known to science, they were said by the inventor to emanate in directions described by the letter Z. Thousands of Midwesterners who had been reading newspaper articles in the early atomic energy days and experiments with heavy water paid $50 for that gadget. They were told that it could expand the atoms of the human body and cure all diseases and restore perfect health. I recall that one precaution, however, was that you couldn't cross your legs when you were taking treatment for this thing. I don't know why. A chemist at the trial testified that Xeris water had the same composition as the water from Chicago City Water Supply where the product was made. Mr. W.R. Ferguson, the inventor and manufacturer, received a 2-year prison sentence, and the distributor, a woman, was sentenced to 1 year. Uranium treatments are another kind of fallout from the atomic age, and these started in the middle 50s when dozens of unsuccessful uranium miners started selling admissions to their abandoned mine tunnels. Victims of arthritis and rheumatic disease pay $2 an hour or more for the privilege of sitting in these mines and so-called absorbing radiation from the surrounding Earth. Other operators truck uranium ore to their treatment centers, set up in vacant store buildings where victims paid to occupy benches in the rooms lined with sacks of the material. Still others sold their ore in pads or pillows, for example. A radio pad, which we took action against, was made of matches sticking and ground up uranium ore. Sold for $7.50, a small size suitable for science. So $37.50 was the price you had to pay for a pillow large enough to treat arthritis and bursitis. There is no therapeutic effect or benefit from uranium ore. Our examination of those devices showed that they had no more radioactivity than an ordinary luminous dial watch. The Cincinnati District Office investigated a uranium treatment center located in Kentucky some time ago, about this time, and the proprietor of the center had rented an empty building in a small Kentucky town, filled it with what he said was uranium ore which he had trucked from Texas. Business was brisk for some time until the Kentucky Food and Drug Authorities investigated along with the food and drug and found that the ore the man was using in his store had in fact been dug from a nearby river in Kentucky. The venture was abandoned shortly thereafter. In contrast to devices distributed directly to consumers, there are expensive diagnostic and treatment machines sold to health practitioners. These may cost from hundreds of dollars to thousands of dollars. The appearance of such machines and their use in a professional atmosphere usually gives patients no reason to be suspicious of their efficacy or safety. Some have been distributed in large numbers. For example, thousands of local practitioners, including a few medical doctors, bought and used the devices invented by the late Dr. Albert Abrams of San Francisco and later by the Electronic Medical Foundation, which he established. Dr. Abrams was the originator of radionics, a system of treatment based on diagnosis by means of blood specimens which were sent to him in San Francisco, where they were placed on an electronic machine called a radioscope. Readings from this machine were sent back to the local practitioner by postcard, telling him the disease the patient was supposed to have and the type of treatment to be given by the other machine, also supplied by the foundation. Investigation by the food and drug inspectors sent blood samples from animals and from dead persons, as well as blood made from colored water. They received diagnoses proving that the machine could not distinguish between the blood of a living or dead person, that of an animal from a human, nor real blood from a colt or a dye, and that the machine was incapable of diagnosing any disease. A federal court injunction prohibited further distribution of blood specimen carriers, the machine, and literature. The microdynamometer is a simple galvanometer for measuring minute electric currents and potentials. It's another such device, one of which we have here. The Food and Drug Administration, physicists, and device experts consider this another application of the old America's first fake medical device called Perkins Tractors, which became a national patent as early as 1795. Mr. Perkins, exploring the little-known property of electricity, theorized that two pieces of dissimilar metal in contact with the body would draw off surcharges of noxious electric fluid that lays at the root of all suffering. The copper and zinc heel plate are examples of that. The probes of the microdynamometer correspond roughly to Mr. Perkins' tractors. The microdynamometer was widely used by health practitioners for a diagnosis of most diseases, including cancer, tuberculosis, until its distribution was stopped by court action. That case eventually went to the Supreme Court of the United States. Some of the machines are undoubtedly still in use, and all this machine did was to measure a difference in electric potential between the two probes. On your body, it would do the same thing on a beefsteak or a wet cement wall. The Food and Drug Administration has made significant progress during the past years in its nationwide crackdown on fake medical devices. During one 24-month period, 111 different types of misbranded or worthless devices were seized. In another 12-month period, 54 different types of diagnostic and treatment devices, all of which bore misbrandings, were seized. During that same period, 358 seizure actions involving 7,986 devices were involved. 832 of these devices, most of these being microdynamometers of this machine, were voluntarily destroyed, making seizure unnecessary. When the Court of Appeals found that the microdynamometer here was not safe even in the hands of a licensed practitioner, this paved the way for a vigorous seizure campaign against these devices. The then Food and Drug Commissioner Larry termed the device, and I quote, a peril to the public health because it cannot diagnose any disease, unquote. Most of quack medical devices fall into several categories. These are as follows generally. Number one, diagnostic and treatment machines such as this. These machines often look impressive with dials, sometimes flashing lights, flickering needles, charts, and impressive console cabinets. Sometimes they are deliberately designed to look like x-ray machines or an electrocardiograph or some other genuine scientific device. And next is radiating devices. Radio waves and other forms of radiation are mysterious to most of us, and we know just enough about medical x-ray and atomic energy to make us gullible for this one with a new form of medical ray. This is a device which I'll explain in a minute. The important fact is that any home gadget giving off enough radiation to have any effect on the human body would be dangerous. If it doesn't have that much radiation, it's worthless. Effective radiation can only be safely used by a physician permitted for that type of operation. The electric and the magnetism devices. Various kinds of fake machines that produce electric shocks, which are here, and these two over here, or generate magnetic forces such as this, are this type. The horse collar or electric bell at one time was demonstrated at county fairs and was intended for treatment of all kinds of diseases through induced magnetic radiation. Next are the light and sound devices. This is a light device. One of the most infamous was the spectacular fake device, the spectrophone, about which we just talked. Air purifiers and negative ion generators, I don't have one of those. Promoters of so-called air purifiers for preventing or treating respiratory infections and other diseases is one of today's most prevalent health swindles. Equipment is available for effective air purification, but it's far more expensive than a small unit sometimes sold in retail stores at $19. These do not have a sufficient capacity for removing dust, pollen, and so forth, which aggravates such allergic conditions as hay fever. No air purifier can truthfully be promoted for treating viral or bacterial diseases such as colds, influenza, pneumonia, and tuberculosis. Vibrating devices, of which we have several, this is an illustration. These come in all shapes and sizes, forms, from their hand units to pillows, rolling pins, chairs, and even mattresses. Vibration is produced by an off-center dryer shaft, usually geared to an electric motor. Some even have heating elements. False claims have been made for the effectiveness of vibrators in treating of a wide range of ailments, such as reducing weight, recontouring the figure, that's a good word, or spot reducing. If you like the sensation provided by a vibrating gadget, that's well and good, but don't expect any medical miracles. Vibrations cannot cure arthritis, rheumatism, circulatory ailments, or even nervous conditions. The next types are devices for erasing the ravages of time. Many of these have been taken off the market as cruel hoaxes. Recent examples are facial stimulators using electric current to produce muscular contractions. And these were claimed to improve the face and neck by erasing wrinkles, sagging muscles, bags under the eyes. We had one called the Erase Your Age, E-R-A-S-U-R-A-G-E, which was just a little bunch of little bands that sit around and pull your double chin out of place and make it go back up in your neck, I suppose. But somebody swiped that, I guess, for you. Down in the office, I'll have to look around. But we know that no machine can turn back the calendar. Now let's take a few minutes and look at some of these gadgets we have here on display. See what they are, what they were represented for, wherein they were in violation of the act, and the action taken against them by the government and their promoters.
I'll take this little one first. This is a device. You see how it works. See these things on the end turn together. They're hard rubber. They're sharp there. And this was, the inventor said, the first advancement in the field of the toothbrush. This was supposed to make the toothbrush. Since man invented the toothbrush originally. It's supposed not only to clean your teeth, but massage your gums, and even would change the shape of the human jawline. I don't know how, that's what he said. Anyhow, you're supposed to stick this and get your teeth in the middle of this and give it a turn. It's supposed to flip out the food particles and massage your gums. But
I would want to use that because I have to chop my guns all to pieces. That's hard rubber in there. And that's what he was chopping. That was taken off the market, and the man eventually abandoned it. Now, this is described in its literature as being a takeoff from the Russian new fleet machine. And it runs on the one place, I feel. This goes over your eye. That little metal door. Metal part like that for contact. This goes on your wrist, the other part of it. And you just turn this on and switch it on, go to sleep at night. And what it does, it says, is you send the almost immeasurable electrical pulsations through your brain, and apparently gets that all your brain, the whole thing to worry about through the sleep. I can't feel anything on my head. You can't tell if it's sensation on it. I don't think it could do you much good, but it was misbranded anyway for that reason, and that has been removed from the market. This is literature that goes with it. This brings up one point that we haven't mentioned, the fact that we have control over imported products of the food, drug, and cosmetic act includes devices. This is a device that was made in Germany and came to the United States, and it actually was misbranded by the man who relabeled it. So we took action against him. And this product, what it is, we call it the electric soapbox. Probably was, really. It had two little batteries in that covered up, and some man wrote on there. I guess the man that made it. And you wear this around your body all day. I guess you hide money in there if you wanted to, too. That would be a more valuable benefit than what you've done. But when the man got through labeling this product, he said it was recommended for wide range of ailments, including asthma, kidney disease, sleeplessness, cramps, rheumatic conditions, heart disease, liver disease, paralysis, and signs of old age. Now, he had something that people would have done that. This is an electrodynamometer I spoke to you about. And actually, it just measures the difference between a potential that we talked about. So, these are the probes or contacts that you can put into onto these things and measure it. This goes on one, and then this goes on the other. And you hold this using the palm of your hand. You remember that picture there? They had one of these on it. They moved it with joke yesterday, and the man was holding these in his hand. And the man was placing the probe on this man's body to find out where the condition was and diagnose that it was cancer. And as I pointed out, after the Supreme Court ruled that these were no good, and upheld the lower court's ruling, a lot of practitioners belonging to one of the organizations that recommended their members bring in these and voluntarily destroy them. Since the court ruled they were no good, they had no reason for having them in their offices. Many of them did that. Hundreds of them turned in, and those that did not, where we knew they were on hand, they were brought under seizure and destroyed. Now, after they are seized, the federal court, we can't seize anything. The government doesn't let the Food and Drug Administration seize anything. We don't have that authority. If we want to seize this, we go to the United States Attorney's Office and tell him, after this has been proved by our experts in Washington, medical doctors and physicists and scientists and physiologists or whatever have you, then we go to the United States Attorney. The United States Attorney will make out what he calls a libel thing. This is in violation of the Act. And that reads United States versus one microdynamometer. That's civil action, see, no persons involved. And whoever owns it can come in and fight it. And if we win, well, then it's destroyed. If he can bring it in compliance with the Act, he can take it down on the bond, post the bond and take it down and change the labeling. They can do that. That's done lots of times on food and bring it in compliance. But these, since they had no useful purpose, this couldn't be relabeled and nothing could be done with it, so they had to destroy it. And as I said in my talk here, I think over 800 of these were brought in. This is one of the types of devices. We have several different types here in our office in Cincinnati, and these are ozone generators. At one time, this was thought to be a very good way to treat certain diseases. Now, here is the type of literature that came out with it, and you can see he starts off, ozone, what is ozone? What does ozone do? What do doctors say? What do users say? How will the ozone benefit you? And they start off, and they all do this, I guess, start off alphabetically with anemia, asthma, arthritis, bronchitis, cirrhosis, colds, colon bacilliosis, constipation, dyspepsia, eczema, fistula, hay fever, headache, influenza, insomnia, inactive liver, inactive kidneys, migraine, mucus, colitis, osteomyelitis, psoriasis, and varicose veins. And then he can't stop there and says, and many other ailments.
So all you have here is just
I believe these now are mercury tubes and
neon tubes, I guess. One of them's you see. Now you'll see. They will smell the ozone here in a moment. You can feel it. You want treatment, doctor? Well, the public health service says that these are harmful. One man told me that one part per million of ozone in the air would kill a canary. And we know a lot of it isn't good for you. Ozone is used, however, in a lot of these instruments they use around the restaurants to kill odors. And it will kill the odors because it oxidizes and gets rid of it. But I don't know where you can smell it there. I'll leave it on a moment. It probably will. But one of our doctors from Washington had a display of these type of devices in some medical convention in Philadelphia several years ago. And he told me that he explained everybody came in, this was fake, and had the signs on here, fake medical devices, not good for anything. And he said he didn't know how many people, despite all that labeling on the device, saying it was fake, no good, come in and ask you why they could buy one. I said, well, why do you think people would do that? He said, I don't know. But he said, here's something that people can feel, they can see it, and they can smell it. And you can feel the little vibration here. And he said, that satisfied all the senses of the body, it must be good for something. He didn't have any to sell, so he didn't do any good. During the twist craze, that was after my dancing days, this became popular. This is called a slim swivel. And you see, you just place this on the floor and you get on there and twist to your heart's content. That's all right, as far as it's for that purpose, but then they start saying that this will help take off that middle roll. Keep the spine supple, tones the back and stomach muscles, slims down those pudgy hips. But our medical experts say they haven't found anything that will take weight off into spot. You got to take it off all over. Now here's another one of the magnetic electric things. This is actually a little shocking machine. And now I'll tell you what they claim to cure. Blood pressure cases, they don't say where high or low, paralysis, arthritis, tired feet, fallen arches, constipation, poor circulation, and then again, many other physical conditions. What this is a low shocking machine. Put your heel here and your foot, ball your foot there, both of them, and then you can turn it on. You can make it either a constant or alternating where it just pulsates. And so taking a little shock through your feet is going to cure these conditions. That's called a pedicine. Now this is one of the radioactive things. This was called the J.R. Hogan Radium Water Company. Now, he's got a little bit of radioactivity in this little cement disc, similar way to call it. So he filled this thing up with water and put this thing in and let it stay all night. And then he says you ought to drink 15 to 16 glasses a day to get the effect of the radioactivity in it. We have some of the literature here with it, and this was taken off the market because, as I said, if you have enough radioactivity, too much of the hurt, if you don't have enough, it's no good anyhow. So there's no halfway space in between that you can go. This is the old-time horse collar that has been talked about so much. Now, I know a lot of these people have had any kind of science. You know, you can feel electricity, you can feel a vibration, but this is horse collar. It's supposed to wear it over your body, you know, to get the electromagnetic waves around it, and to give the body its benefit. And here he's got quite a bunch of conditions here. He starts with arthritis, asthma, bladder trouble, Bright's disease, bronchitis, eczema, he goes on down, heart trouble, lumbago, all the way down to varicose veins like the others. And we set up this little cube, this little thing here to show that there is an electromagnetic wave cause this little flashlight bulb to see will electricity. Since this all thing is current back and forth and cutting the field creeping up trying to turn that little bulb on. So that's what they use to check to show people they're really getting benefits from this thing. This is just a vibrator, a mini type. You have a hand type, the type you lie down on, a great big chair. This is kind of a pillow thing, made up rather nicely. And you can adjust it here. Let's see, maybe you can tune this in and see what they get.
Hey, it makes me noise.
Yeah.
Jump on the plate. So these are, I don't know what this one's recommended for particularly, but all of them, they go from such things as help natural functioning of ductless glands, reduces cerebral hypertension, migraine headache, impaired hearing, prostate gland trouble, internal cancer, tumors, receding gums, poor vision, poor digestion, varicose veins, hardening of the arteries, and to clear up the sinuses. I guess it's shake the sinuses out. This is, Dr. Sinovitz was talking about this. This is called a surname, it's two-piece suit. It's kind of a rubberized thing that you put on to lose weight. And Dr. Sinovitz pointed out that all you lose is just a little moisture. And most of you say that it would be permanent. That's it says, you athletes wait a slimmer hip. Athletes and others have used this method of weight reduction for years with practical results. The article was seized by the Food and Drug Administration because of misleading in that the labeling and the inserts as described above suggest the article is adequate and effective for weight reduction and spot reduction, which statements are false and misleading. If you go to the use, it would come over your hips and any other part of your body, I think, equally, as far as I know. Now this is called a Vibra Shot, and this is a rather old device. People would say, oh, you got a plumber's helper, but that plumber's helper can't do these miracles. This has a little place here you can adjust the amount of air that goes in and out. This is to be hooked on the vacuum cleaner. And originally had a little piece of rubber over it, but if you put on the vacuum cleaner, it would vibrate up and down. And the literature said that you could hear the fat being sucked off. I don't know where it went, probably in the vacuum bag. Now, I have a good explanation for having these now. You might wonder why, but there's a good reason. This pocket manufacturer was located in Western Kentucky some years ago. And so he had a gimmick for selling more stockings. So he bathed these stockings in beauty preparations such as mink oil, turtle oil, royal jelly, lanolin, and sesame oil. And then he made made statements on here that they would be effective for making your legs beautiful, regardless of any other considerations. And of course, when you put turtle oil in face creams and things like that, well, I began to wonder about these things. But the man was quite flabbergasted that we had any jurisdiction over. See, that becomes a drug when it's recommended for treating or affecting the condition of the body. Beautifying would be cosmetic, but changing the condition of the body and making it look young. And some of these other statements he made over here caused it to be in violation. So what he did, he took these down on the barn after they were seized. As I told you, if you can't bring a product in compliance, the court will allow it. He took these back to his place, took this labeling out, washed the beautiful beautifying preparations out, and sold them in stocking. This was all right with us. This is an item I have just come in, just come to know here. And it's called the Matheson Chevrolet Pendulum. And just reading the directions here, you're supposed to take this thing and hold it like this. And you find out whether this means yes by asking it some questions. And maybe that'll mean yes, and this will mean no. And I said, clockwise circling motion, which is usually agreed upon as indicating I do not know. The counterclockwise says I refuse to answer this time. I presume they've been listening to some of the congressional hearings on the grounds it might incriminate me. Many persons employ the pendulum to check on food requirements. Any food cooked or uncooked may be tested as follows. Hold the pendulum over the food, as for example, over near corn, a basket of tomatoes, or food cooked or uncooked in half. Is this food good for me at this time? If you get a no, then ask a detailed question about the food, which can be answered yes or no. For example, is it stale, spoiled, overcooked, undercooked, contaminated? Are these poisons present from sprays or chemicals and so on? And other letters here, it doesn't say in here, but it also says you could ask a question such as this. Am I pregnant, and will my coming baby be boy or girl? is supposed to be able to answer these for you. And it indicated in here that it determines whether or not pregnancy had taken place within a minute.
So that is a wonderful device.
Now, the spectrophone there, I think we've talked about this a couple of times, but that shows what it's made out. Made out. This, Mr. Ganielli was an East Indian. I was fortunate to be able to sit in court one day when he contested our city as a survivor in Brooklyn back then in the late 40s. This device is made of this aluminum box. This was made before the war when he's getting in there. And inside is a simple bag. This is some out of the instrument. Then we'll turn it down and see if I can. Watt bulb, a little 98% electric fan, 90% of that time, heat it through, condensing lead, and there's a safe in here for a bottle of water to absorb some of the heat before then to the vent when cracking. And over in here, of course, he poo-pooed all that when we started talking about that water. He said, well, the important part of these special figured pieces of glass. And I'll turn this on and see how it works. You can make it either one color or you can make combinations of colors there for a single disease. And Mr. Gadiel's theory was that the reason the body was ill was because it all back to certain color in your body. So you can see the blue there, or color over here, using yellow, or you can make a combination of yellow and red for a darker red. And his book told you what color to use. So if you used yellow maker to cure cancer, why, then that was all right. He would be through with you. You wouldn't have to go back to him if you knew all that. So his theory also indicated that every time that the sign of the zodiac changed, well, you'd have to change color. So then you'd have to buy a magazine every month. He wouldn't tell you that he was able to see the $90 menu of the month of stars. And you had to come to his place over there in New Jersey and take a course. And after you took maybe a week's course, he would give you a degree. Then you were called a spectrochrome operator. And then when you took spectrochrome, then you were a master spectrochrome master. And then you took another, I think you were a doctor of that. And then you start toxicity and starting for this condition. Now, he had his group organized into what they call clinics. And that was a group of people who came in. And then they actually were in at that time, then they could go out and form their own clinics and sell these treatments themselves. This was an interesting trial. Mr. Gadiel was a brilliant person. He had about 10 degrees behind his name. Most of those he had given, I think all of them he gave to himself, and one of them had an honorary MD degree from some diploma college, diploma mill, for which he had written a paper on some medical problems. Mr. Gadiel, he went to court with the same thing as a concept of a religion. And we were able to prove, however, that many of these people he had listed in his lecture as being cured were actually dead. He had one man testifying for him in court, who said he hadn't had an epileptic seizure in the last 2 years since he had been using the spectrum. However, while he was on the stand, he did have a seizure, and they were worried that there might have been some serious result that there had been maybe enough young doctor there to administer to him. So he was a wonderful one of the old timers who got into this area and stayed there. He mixed this with Mr. Desmond too, because he advertised as being a colonel or colonel in the New York City Air Force. And he looked into that and during World War I, he went and volunteered his services to the New York City Police Department to be in their Air Force. He just pictured himself as an old World War I general and his flying top. Type legends and things like that. And the police department said, well, if you wanted that, we didn't do that, so he told him to cook. And that was one thing he did up there, and his accomplishment was being found in the Air Force.
He also had a lot of these degrees like master experiments that he did himself, most of them. And after he got through all of those, he had ETC down there. Everybody else, everybody wondered what that meant. Nobody could figure out, I guess, et cetera. But he went all the way sure, you also knew. But what actually happened after the season, he kept going. Found that these things were misbranded and wanted to thank you. But then he kept going, and then they brought him in the court again, obtaining him, jumping, and then he kept corresponding with people even after that. He had 9 boys. I think it's 10. And a little girl was born then, I think, to his wife after he was about 75 years old. But this gentleman passed away about 4 or 5 years ago, I think, in his life. But he had things like this. He said he wasn't supposed to eat some of the East Indian mixes. He wasn't supposed to eat honey. He says honey is a filter product because it is produced by the regurgitation of the bee. And he had a lot of other things went on along with that, using certain fruit to certain scientists today. This is really one of the granddaddies of the Bible.
I believe,
let's see this. I'd like to go look at this. This is an interesting thing. And one of our most recent. This is called a splendidron. And this is where it looks. What it is, it's a shocking machine. I mean, actually, shock electricity. And it has a little pad here. You're supposed to put the sponge comes to sit on these and you moisten them so you get proper electricity. And you'll place these on the part of the body you want to use. If you don't get to use, one goes here and one goes over here, and you turn it on. And what happened is a little dose of electricity goes through here. And the theory is that if these doses of electricity go through, your muscles contract. And therefore, by contracting the muscles, this is essentially equivalent to taking exercise while you're sitting down. Now, this was put out by a Slendertron of Dallas, Texas, and it kept getting so bad till we seized a few of them and the firm kept on. And eventually, we obtained an injunction against the firm to prohibit them from shipping this in interstate commerce. But since that time, we find the same thing showing up all over the country, all over our territory, under different names. And we found that they had been distributed in Louisville, Kentucky, and Warsaw, Kentucky, and Nashville, Tennessee. And these people kept going rather rapidly. And they gave you a certificate. Now, this literature is for the isotron. Some of them they call the isotron and the so forth because they can't ship them the spinotron because they're prohibited by questions during that. But we had one of our experts figure out how much this thing would cost. And he said that he could build the same thing for $45.23, and he made a tabulation here. Give you some idea of how these cost. Now here is a price list we found in this one that was seized. It's a Slendertron of Cincinnati, I guess that's near Ohio. We have them at 2 in Dayton, Ohio. Here are the prices for these, depending on the kind of finish, you know, 350, 340, 330, 320, 310, 300, 250, and 200. Now this, I believe, is one of the $350 set. And here's the way you pay for it. Let's see, he bought it and paid down $19.50. He signed the note, which included the carrying charges for $463. So we jumped from $350 to $463. Plus life insurance of $9.58. So this man's going to be paying, the cost of this thing jumped from $48 up to $350, and then all your carrying charges, it goes up to that's the note for $463. Plus your down payment, that makes it $474 for this thing. And you'll find that most of these people, if they would sell this thing for $15, a lot of people would say, heck, you can't have anything that's good for $15, but you sell it up about some medical instrument would cost it, and they'll buy it. I did the figure analysis, I don't know what this happened, but it showed you how to use this device here for reducing the waste and other parts of your body here. And it gives you, so you're supposed to keep a list here. They come in and measure you, and you know,
imagine you get loose, so you give you a treatment, then you pull it, you take it tight, and say, well, you're off an inch on your waist already. And that's very impressive, you know. People usually think that everybody is inherently honest, that we're likely to believe these people when they tell us these things. They have just even a picture of Venus de Milo in here. They have a guarantee. And I don't know what guarantee does, but the way these people would do, they would sell these things to you, get your name on a note, and then they would run downtown and turn this over to a collection agency, and the collection agency would buy this and pay them off, and then they'd go to another town before you could catch up with them. And they're down way below Nashville, Tennessee by now. First time we saw them were up in Dayton, Ohio. If we could prove that these actually were coming out of the Dallas office, that it would be a violation of the injunction, and we could go there and tell the judge that these people are still marketing these things, but we haven't really been able to prove them yet, but somewhere along the line, they'll let their guard down and we will be able to prove that.